enjoy today. It sounds like things could be a little less pleasant in the next few days, although I think what Stafford County is probably not going to get much, at least they say now. So hopefully no freezing rain and things. One thing before we get started with the service, remember the announcements are going to be at the end to let Nate get out of here. We are reading half the Bible today, so we do not want to dawdle. Sandy has the faith flyers. And Sandy, would it be okay if they're going to see somebody that's not here, they could take it to them?
I've been doing that, yeah.
Okay. If you would all now please turn to number 880 in your hymnal, the Nicene Creed, and stand as you are comfortable, and we will do this together. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us and for our salvation. He came down from heaven, was incarnate in the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. If you would remain standing and turn to hymn number 529, How Firm a Foundation. God, you so loved the world as to give your only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Grant to us the precious gift of faith, that we may know that the Son of God is come, and may have power to overcome the world and gain a blessed immortality. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. If you would all please be seated. Our Old Testament reading today comes from Jeremiah. It is the first chapter and verses 4 through 10. And it is entitled Jeremiah's Call and Commission. Now the word of the Lord came to me, saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations. Then I said, ah, Lord God, truly I do not know how to speak, for I am only a boy. But the Lord said to me, do not say, I am only a boy, for you shall go to all to whom I send you, and you shall speak whatever I command you. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you to deliver you, says the Lord. Then the Lord put out his hand and touched my mouth, and the Lord said to me, now I have put my words in your mouth. See, today I appoint you over nations and over kingdoms, to pluck up and to pull down, to destroy and to overthrow, to build and to plant.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
It is indeed good to be back home, and for those of you who didn't, those of you who did not know, I spent the week in Concordia at licensing school, the first week of licensing school. The second week will be held in July. And I do sincerely appreciate all your prayers for me and for my family this last week. In many ways, your prayers were answered, and I know that you prayed faithfully, and I appreciate that. This morning, we're going to do prayer just a little bit different, if we may. We're going to start with a time of confession, but first I want to just encourage you to just relax. Take a deep breath and let it out. And rest in the Lord. Would you pray this prayer of confession with me? Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love, according to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against you, you only have I sinned, and done that which is evil in your sight, so that you are justified in your sentence and blameless in your judgment. Behold, I was born into iniquity, and I have been sinful since my mother conceived me. Behold, you desire truth in the inward being, therefore teach me wisdom in my secret heart. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Make me hear with joy and gladness. Let the bones which you have broken rejoice. Hide your face from my sins. Blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of your salvation, and sustain me, a willing spirit. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will return to you. Deliver me from death, O God of my salvation, and my tongue will sing aloud of your deliverance. O Lord, open my lip, my lips, and my mouth shall show forth your praise. For you have no delight in sacrifice. Were I to give a burnt offering, you would not be pleased. The sacrifice acceptable to God is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. O God, you will not despise. As we move into our time of intercession, praying for each other and for other concerns that we may have, I invite you to speak in short order the concern that you have. I will follow with, Lord, in your mercy, and together we will say, hear our prayer. Together let us pray for the people of this congregation, those who suffer and are in trouble, the concerns of the local community, the world, the people, and its leaders, the Church Universal and its leaders, members, and mission, and the communion of the saints. Shall we bow? Say the name of the person that you have a concern for.
Deliver us.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Joe Allen.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Roger Clark.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Mark Louis McDonald.
Lord, in your mercy. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Norman Cooper.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Laura Coleman.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For the winter storm coming in, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For our children away at college, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
The children in our Sunday school classes,
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
For the teachers in our school, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory of forever. Amen.
Our hymn is number 191, Jesus Loves Me, and we will sing the first verse only.
Jesus, love me, as I now am.
175 of the New Testament. This is 1 Corinthians chapter 13, and I think you will recognize it. If I speak in the tongues of mortals and angels, but do not have love, I am a noising gong or clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but I do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away all my possessions, and if I hand over my body so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. But as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part, and we prophesy only in part. But when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. When I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part, then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. And now faith, hope, and love abide. These three. And the greatest of these is love. May God add his blessing to the reading of his holy word.
Thanks be to God.
Well, the last couple of weeks we've been learning about spiritual gifts from 1 Corinthians 12. Nuggets of God's grace that he's given to each one of us individually. That help us as individuals contribute something of value to build up the church. We've learned that the church is a body with many parts or members, and each one has its place of purpose and value. And we were encouraged to be the part God has called us to be as individuals, working together so that the church doesn't become a monster. Remember that from last week? But it is truly the compassionate body of Christ on earth. Now, we come to chapter 13. What is this chapter doing here? Seems like we only hear it at weddings, right? It's a very common text used for the sermon at weddings. The early church missionary and church planter Paul, the apostle, wrote it. How many preachers have we heard raptured into heaven on these words during weddings? How useful was it to us? Because not only do many of our marriages fail, but our churches split. Thinking ecstatically about these words isn't necessarily the point of the words at all. Was Paul preaching at a wedding? Doesn't appear to be. He was continuing to deal with conflict in the church in Corinth. And that's why he wrote this chapter. People in position and affluence are taking advantage of those who don't have these things. People have all kinds of spiritual gifts in the church in Corinth. They speak in tongues and they prophesy and they have gifts of faith and knowledge and hospitality and so on. And Paul says, whoopee, good for you people. They are a house divided. Unless something changes, that house will not stand. So it was a very critical moment in the time of the church in Corinth. And there is no question as to the value of spiritual gifts, according to Paul. The Holy Spirit gave them to the church as an extension of God's grace for this time. Their value is not in question, the spiritual gifts. Paul's concern is how that they are used. When the person who only has a few cents to throw into the offering plate is allowed to only eat leftovers after those who contribute the most have gone through the line in the fellowship dinner, something's wrong. When the ethnic people have to stand in the back of the church so that there's room for the wealthy Jews to sit in the front and close to the teacher, something is wrong. When the gift of tongues is used as a club to beat up on those who don't happen to have that gift, something is wrong. My own grandfather left the Pentecostal church my great-grandmother took him to as a boy. Why? Because he was ostracized for having never obtained the gift of tongues. And he was unwilling to fake it like many of the other people did so that they could fit in. So my grandfather joined the Baptist church where they rejected the sign gifts altogether. Was he better off? I don't think so. There was just as much strife in the Baptist church as anywhere else. Look how many Baptist split-offs we have. Such division is not acceptable in the body of Christ. And that's what Paul is speaking against. The Corinthian church body has all of the spiritual gifts present, even the sign gifts, which Paul does not question are legitimate. At the same time, however, they tolerate or endorse illicit sexuality, greed, and idolatry. My friends, this must never be, not in the church. Where does this come from? Where do these things arise from? What has happened is the church in Corinth has been evangelized by the Greeks and their philosophies. There were groups who believed that wisdom and knowledge was true reality, and what they did in the flesh was of no eternal consequence. This same philosophy exists in the church even today. Paul recognizes this problem all the way back in the first century. And so what he says to the church in Corinth, he also says to us, and we would be wise to hear. He explains that there is a clear solution to the conflicts we have because of our flawed thinking. Every conflict that we have. He uses himself, his own ministry, his own spiritual gifts as an example to us. According to Brother Paul, he explains that God's love in the body has three characteristics found right here in 1 Corinthians 13. Verses 1 through 3 is the first one, where he emphasizes the absolute necessity of love. And the kind of love that he is talking about is that unconditional, sacrificial love, agape love, as we have come to understand it. Agape love. It's absolutely necessary. He talks about his speaking in tongues. He talks about prophecy and mysteries and knowledge and faith that can move mountains and faith that has the power to work miracles and giving up his possessions to the poor and even handing or surrendering his body to the flames or for the glory of the ministry, for the glory of Christ. All of these things are worthless without what? Each of these is best understood in direct reference to Paul's own behavior. Paul insists that if any of these acts is not motivated by agape love, it is of no value, least of all to himself. Agape is the wellspring from which his ministry flows. Love is absolutely necessary. So, secondly, it's the character. Verses 4 through 7, we see that the character of agape is described. And the contrast between agape and eros, which is the Greek word where we get our word erotic, which has to do with romantic love. There's a huge difference between that and this agape love that is self-sacrificing, yet also unconditional. There's a drastic contrast, and Paul makes this, explains this. And there is a lot of literature on the significance of that word agape in history. What each of us has the spiritual gifts stresses is self-giving, sacrificial behavior, and it builds up the church, whereas gnosis or knowledge puffs up. I am so smart that I have been to seminary and I know more than you all do, and so I am up here so that I can bestow unto you the vast treasures of my knowledge, right? That is not agape love, is it? If I was to use a preaching gift or a gift of, you know, a prophecy of proclaiming the word in that way, it would have no love, and therefore it'd be absolutely worthless. And how many of you would stick around till even next week to hear me preach? If I had that attitude. Love does not insist on its own way. It is not egocentric, but self-giving, self-sacrificing. This is the way of Christ. This is what Christ did. He humbled himself. And if you look at Philippians chapter 2, verses 4 through 11, a beautiful display of Christ's the process of how Christ humbled himself. Even though he was equal with God, he is God fully. He humbled himself, became a man, took on the form of a servant, gave up his own life on the cross, and so on. The expected normal Christian behavior is agape, self-sacrificing. And it's the earmark of Paul's ministry. So, first necessity, and secondly, the character of this love, and thirdly, the permanence of this love. He presents agape as the supreme eternal reality that never ends. It never ends. In fact, there's no beginning to it. Why? Because before all things, God is. And what is God? Who is God? God is love. This agape love. And he is eternal. And therefore, it is eternal. By contrast, the other gifts from the Spirit, such as tongues, knowledge, and prophesying, hospitality, and so forth. They're all limited, short-term things. These are for here only, for the church age only. Because what happens when we are face-to-face with Jesus for eternity? Do we need these things anymore? No. These things were here and now and are here and now for one purpose and one purpose only, and that is to point us to Jesus. Once we are face to face, we see clearly we need not these gifts. Agape exists in creation, the cross, the resurrection, the coming of the Holy Spirit, and in the here and now and forever into the future. It is the past and future, eternal, the perpetual light of Christ shining throughout all ages. It doesn't need to be changed or altered in any form. It is eternal. Even when our Lord returns in the clouds with glory, love endures. Because it represents the dimension of God that reaches from the future into the present through the Christ event, through Christ's coming. Romans 8:39 says that nothing in all creation can separate us from His love. Love your neighbor, period. Because love lasts forever. In his book, Mere Christianity, C.S. Lewis wrote, "Do not waste your time bothering whether you love your neighbor. Act as though you did. Act as if you do love them." As soon as we do this, C.S. Lewis says, we find one of the great secrets. When you are behaving as if you love someone, you will presently come to love him. When we lovingly use our spiritual gifts to love our neighbor, we increase or strengthen the depth of love in the church, in the body of Christ. Faith and hope are important for now. But once face to face, faith and hope have been realized and are no longer necessary. For we have it. 100%. We have nothing else to look forward to. But love remains. The fellowship of the Spirit through the bond of peace remains. Agape love exists for all time. And that's why love is the greatest of these. So let me encourage you to use your spiritual gifts by all means to build up the church. Use them in love. Act like you love your neighbor. Because if you do, you will. May God bless the preaching of His holy word. Amen.
Because if you keep doing the right thing and you don't mean it, eventually you will. If you would all now please turn with me and we will join in our offering prayer. And after the prayer, if Mr. Schultz and Mr. Norton could help Kenny and Marge, I would appreciate that. Let us pray. O Lord, our Savior, we praise you for your constant care. We are grateful that you have claimed us as your own, that we belong to you as part of your people. Thank you for drawing us to this congregation where we share in worship and study, friendship and service with others who love you. Let our lives be useful for your purposes. We gladly give our tithes and offerings as a sign of the joy you give us to share with the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If the ushers will please come forward for the morning offering. We now come to our announcements, any special recognitions, and we really didn't get a chance to do a lot with that during the prayer thing that we were doing a little differently. So are there any joys that we need to share?
Well, this is nice weather for January.
Yes. Now, on the concern side, I think we're going to pay for it. But, in fact, we rent a call last night out in Colorado, and it was snowing there, kind of blustery.
And it's a joy to see. You look so nice this morning.
I'm glad that my haircut brings you pleasure, though.
You look handsome.
Well, okay, then I would suggest you call up your eye doctor and get busy, but thank you. Any other joys? I know that the girls competed this week in their tournament and won a game or two, right? I know they won at least one. Or did they? I thought maybe they had won two. So that's good news.
They lost one, I'm sorry.
Okay, well, but
they won one.
They won one. And so are there any other joys?
Yeah, from the Southern Baptist Church over at Kenwood, another good service.
Yeah. Okay, had a nice service with the Southern Baptist minister?
Yeah.
Great.
His wife plays the piano. You know, he used to be the band teacher here.
Oh, Bill Clausen, Rita.
Yeah.
Good. We're glad that Bill and Rita still help out in the community.
I really like that because my brother, who's 7 years older than me, was a tremendous piano player. He was the one who got killed in France.
And for those of you who don't know, Rita is kind of self-taught.
Yeah.
And so her ability to do she really did most of that working hard on her own. Mm. And if those of you, that's really something to be able to be that good.
It's really a thrill when they roll that piano out and she can play that piano. It's just like the old times with my brother when he went to church.
We're glad, and it's a good ministry for the Ministerial Alliance to make sure that we are able to have church at Kenwood every Saturday. That's a special blessing. Okay, Nate survived his trip to Concordia. He got out of the convent. That's where he was, right? He was in a convent, which I didn't know Methodists had convents, but... this Saturday, Nate will be doing the Kenwood service. So that's good. Sneaking up a week from this Wednesday, we are already at the start of Lent. So what, a week from Wednesday, that will also be the morning of the first Lenten breakfast, 7 a.m. Sandy, do we know who the first speaker is yet?
I think it's Nate, but I haven't got that.
Because I know Nate's probably going to have to balance here and Stafford, and I know he'll do his very best.
I see Dorothy Bliss has another birthday.
That's a good thing.
Sure, probably.
But we haven't got the birthdays yet.
Oh, well, I thought you were...
No, I'm just trying to do everything, And then in 2 weeks from this Wednesday, Sandy, is the UMW Fellowship Hall at 11:45. Anything need to be said about that? Come hungry, show up. Any special thing going on?
Just trying to get reorganized.
Okay. And any of you guys want to say anything about the bells?
Yeah. We're going to try to play on Easter.
You're going to try to play bells on Easter? So do you have enough folks? Could you use a couple more folks?
Well, hopefully this week we'll get a couple that weren't there last week, or three. And we're practicing on Wednesdays. We start playing at 5:30.
Wednesday at 5:30 sharp.
Yes.
So they will be picking up the bells. We tell our students on time is late.
Yep.
So you can be ready to go at 5:30. That's great. Now, before we forget, Dorothy Bliss' birthday. Are there any birthdays that we don't have listed or anniversaries? Okay, well, let's sing happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you, happy birthday, God bless you, happy birthday to you.
Okay, it looks like, any again, if you haven't, and I'm sure Sandy caught most everybody, get your faith flyer. If you're going to be visiting somebody who wasn't here this week, save us a little postage, because what is it, 49 cents a stamp. Please be careful with the weather, because I think they're talking about, 40-mile-an-hour winds and things. So unless you're a cattle farmer, you got no reason to be out when it's that crappy. So let's everybody be safe. Any announcements that we missed? Anything that needs to be brought up regarding anything going on with the Dillon's closing? Anything like that?
Nothing known for sure.
Okay, nothing known for sure. I know they had a couple things on the radio, and it's been on TV a few times and that kind of thing, so I just thought I'd check.
Vic?
Yes, sir?
I think Tuesday night, I don't know what time, possibly.
So is that the council meeting?
But they're having a council meeting back then behind the barbershop there, the Shell Building, I think is where it's at.
Okay, yeah, I did read that in the paper, thanks, Kenny.
7 o'clock.
At 7 o'clock, they're moving the council meeting from upstairs above the city building to the Shell Building, which is behind Kenny's place. And I bet if you need a haircut, you'd help him out, wouldn't you?
No, I'm going to listen to it.
Oh, okay. But, so I'm sure that they're expecting a big crowd and input. Anything else? Please remain seated, and we will sing number 399, Take My Life and Let It Be. Faith, hope, and love abide with us forever.